So before we really get into the code itself, we thought that we'd just provide a little bit of background on why the IESBA decided to take on this multi-year project to revise and restructure the code. And the short answer is that the board really wanted to ensure that the code was relevant and fit for purpose, not only for today, but really getting into the future. It's obviously a lot of change that's going on. So over the past number of years, there clearly have been a variety of ethics failings in the business world, things like breaches of independence, breaches of the code, questionable, frankly, ethical activity by professional accountants in a number of roles. And these have, I think, shone a spotlight on the need for the accounting profession to place an even greater emphasis on professional ethics, right at the core of what we all do. And that's putting an increased pressure, of course, also on regulators. In addition, there's been a fair amount of discussion about public accounting firms and business models, or the models that firms are looking to adopt. Many firms are allocating a lot of time and effort into their advisory practices, which, again, inevitably is going to lead to questions, again, primarily coming from regulators, about how those changing business models can impact service quality. So taken together, all of those situations have heightened expectations for ethics within our profession. And then similarly, as we sort of alluded to as well, as we move forward in the digital age and we're facing new uncertainties, the profession has to be thinking about how we rely so heavily on ethics and trust at our to the public and clients and employers more broadly. So the board's goal was to revise and restructure the code in a way that not only ensured that the code serves the needs of today's profession, but also that it would serve as that strong base going forward. From a practical perspective, the process of revising and restructuring, of course, relied very heavily, as it always does, on feedback and insight from a broad range of stakeholders, most notably PAOs. And so the board thanks you as well for your efforts. And hopefully you can see significant evidence of your suggestions in the newest iteration of the code as we go through here. Okay, next slide, please.
Perfect, and good morning, everyone. I'll just run through the agenda for the session. So we'll start with a quick bit of background about the IESBA, and then we'll do an overview of the revised and restructured code, and focusing in on some of the key enhancements from the extant code. And we'll walk you through the structure or architecture of the new code, and then provide some guidance on some of the resources and tools that are available to help with the implementation of the revised code. Then, once we've all got a better sense of the major changes and what the code looks like now, Brian's going to give us some information about the e-code project and give you a better sense about that new tool. And then we'll close out by taking a quick look at what more broadly lies ahead for the IESBA's work plan.
And then moving on to the next slide. Great, thanks. So as Laura mentioned, we'll begin with just some very quick background about the IESBA. Like our sister board, the IAASB, we're an independent standard-setting body serving in the public interest by setting robust, internationally appropriate, in our case, ethics standards, including auditor independence requirements for the professional accountants around the world. As you're undoubtedly aware, our principal output is the International Code of Ethics for Professional Accountants, including the International Independence Standard. In short, we lovingly refer to this whole document as simply the code. In terms of composition, our board is comprised of a mix of members from all six continents, of the significantly inhabited ones anyway, with public practitioner and also non-practitioner volunteers. Our board is chaired by a public member, Stavros Tomadakis. And our members are appointed by the IFAC board, subject to the approval of the Public Interest Oversight Board. And then with respect to process, the PAOB provides oversight, and the Consultative Advisory Group, or the IESBA CAG, provides advice. Both of those groups send representation to attend each of our meetings. The board standard setting process is thorough, to say the least, I would say. Founded on the open and transparent debate of issues. So exposing all draft standards and guidance documentation for public comment, engaging in public discussion and consideration of the comments that are received and then also of their disposition before any final standards get pronounced.
If we can move on to the next slide. Thank you. So then a key benefit of that rigorous and open process that Brian just described is the very widespread adoption of the IESBA code around the world. So the code's being used in more than 120 countries, either directly or as the basis for local codes of ethics. It's also been adopted by the Forum of Firms for transnational audits. And there are translations for the extant code that are available in 39 languages. And we would expect that in time, of course, the revised and restructured code will have a similar or a greater reach in terms of translation. So this widespread adoption is important on a couple of fronts. Acceptance and commitment to these norms results in predictability, I guess, in terms of expectations and accountability for professional accountants. And promoting high ethics standards and accountability, in turn, supports the stability of financial information preparation, as well as assurance, and that obviously has a positive economic impact. We cannot overstate the importance of this, particularly as the world becomes more and more connected and interdependent.
And then on to the next slide. All right, so enough about the background, about who we are. Let's talk about the new code itself. So this was a document that was released in April of last year, and it's going to be effective as of this coming June 15th. The process of developing the revised code was fairly intense. It involved considerable multi-stakeholder consultations, as those of you who were involved in responding to the various exposure drafts and discussion papers no doubt recall. Starting with some of the structural elements, the new design is really geared toward being more user-friendly so that professional accountants can find relevant guidance, for example, when they're faced with ethics-related issues or dilemmas in their work environment, and then also just more generally to promote positive ethical behavior. A guide to the code is right up front, and that serves as a roadmap of sorts by helping professional accountants understand how to navigate the code. And the guide also illustrates how the code is structured and discusses how it should be used. This guide also highlights the critical importance of the fundamental principles and the conceptual framework and how they work together as that foundation of the code as a whole. And there's also a very clear expectation in the revised code between requirements and application material. And you'll see that the requirements paragraphs are denoted with the letter R in each case, whereas related application material that's included for guidance is labeled with the letter A. So this approach really strongly supports enforceability, which was yet another of the key objectives of the revisions that stakeholders were looking for. And then once again, the full title of the code is at the bottom of the slide there, and you'll note that it conveys the importance of having independence requirements that are embedded directly into the code.
Okay, if we can move on. Perfect, thanks. So those are some of the design elements, and from a content perspective, the new code includes some very significant revisions and effectively packages up all of the advances in standards that have come about over the last 4 or so years. Something that definitely added to the complexity of the project was that while the restructuring was going on, a number of significant sections were either being created or changed at the same time. And within the code, there were significant changes made to the conceptual framework, from positioning it much more prominently, as Brian mentioned. It's recognizing, though, that its significance in terms of importance right at the core of that ethical decision-making by professional accountants. The code also includes enhanced safeguards provisions, and those better define what safeguards are, and also more closely match the safeguards with the threats to compliance with the fundamental principles. The standards regarding what professional accountants can and should do if they become aware of NOCLAR, so non-compliance with laws and regulations by their employer or by a client, those have also been included in the new code. And as well, a number of additional provisions have been strengthened, including the independence requirements around long association of auditors and the clients, and requirements regarding situations where inducements are offered to a professional accountant. Then next, there are new and revised requirements specific to professional accountants in business, including new considerations when preparing or presenting information, and requirements to follow when facing pressure to breach the fundamental principles. And another revision was to add clear guidance for professional accountants in public practice to be aware that some of the provisions for professional accountants in business actually apply to practitioners as well, and that ties to their role and their activities in their firm. And finally, the new code provides clearer guidance on the importance of understanding facts and circumstances when we're exercising professional judgment, as well as new application material to explain how compliance with the fundamental principles supports the exercise of professional skepticism in assurance engagements. And we'll take a closer look at a few of these in a bit more depth in a moment. But first, Brian's going to provide an overview of the revised and restructured code's architecture for us.
Okay, on the next slide. Thanks. So on this slide, you can see the distinct parts of the code, beginning with the overarching part one that applies to all professional accounts. So in this part is the introduction to the fundamental principles and the conceptual framework. And again, it explains how the conceptual framework is to be applied. Then next, moving down, the requirements and guidance for professional accountants in business have been moved into part two. And this is to provide a better flow to the code. And also, it highlights the applicability of the code to all roles by putting this piece up front. Just a reminder as well that within the code, the words in business includes those professional accountants who are working in industry and in government, not-for-profit, and so on. Essentially, any professional accountants not in a public practice role. Although, as I previously mentioned and is shown on slide on this particular slide, Part 2 is also applicable to individual practitioners when they're performing professional activities related to their relationship with the firm rather than clients. Part 3 and 4 are very squarely aimed at professional accountants in public practice, with general requirements for all practitioners that are found in Part 3, including things like conflicts of interest, fees, inducements, no-clar, and so on. We'll talk about some of those as we go along here. And then the specific independence requirements follow in Parts 4A. 4A relates to audit and review engagements, and then in Part 4B deals with other assurance engagements. Then at the end of the code, you'll find the glossary, which includes some additional terms that we've accumulated as a result of the projects over the last few years as well.
Okay, if we can move on to the next slide, please. So let's talk a bit more about the fundamental principles and the conceptual framework, as these really are at the heart of the code. So the fundamental principles haven't changed. There's still integrity, objectivity, professional confidence and due care, confidentiality, and professional behavior. And these principles establish the standard of behavior that's expected of all professional accountants, and they reflect the profession's clear recognition of its public interest responsibility. Another thing that hasn't changed is the overarching requirement for all PAs to apply the conceptual framework to comply with the principles. And one thing to note is that independence is not a fundamental principle, but the categories of threats to independence are the same as those threats to the fundamental principles themselves, and hence the connection here. So therefore, the code clarifies and now explicitly states that the conceptual framework applies to compliance with independence in the same way that it does to compliance with the fundamental principles more generally.
Next slide then. Okay, as Laura mentioned earlier, one of the big changes to the codes is the prominence that's now given to the conceptual framework, which is set out in section 120. And note also that each of the other parts begins with a discussion of applying the conceptual framework within the context of the role that's discussed in that particular part before moving on to the specifics of the part. So again, that really illustrates how the conceptual framework is at the core of each of these decision-making processes, regardless of the role that the professional account is in. So the conceptual framework provides a systematic three-step approach for professional accountants to use in identifying the threats to compliance with the fundamental principles and to independence where that's applicable, evaluating the significance of those threats that have been identified, and then finally addressing the threats. Then just as an aside, the threats to compliance with the fundamental principles and to independence are unchanged in the revised and restructured code. So those are still self-interest, self-review, advocacy, familiarity, and intimidation.
Okay, moving on again then. So in addition to this more sort of front and center placement of the conceptual framework, there was a lot of other work done on it to make it much more applicable. The revised conceptual framework specifies that identified threats that are not at an acceptable level have to be addressed in one of three ways, either by eliminating the circumstances that are creating the threats, so for example, by divesting of a financial interest, if that's what's causing a threat, by applying safeguards, for example, by reassigning duties or adding oversight and so on, or by declining or ending the specific professional activity or service. So for example, by not accepting the job or not continuing the engagement. And there's an added emphasis on that last point here, that if the threats can't be addressed, the professional accountant must decline or end the specific professional activity that's giving rise to that threat. And the concept of safeguards has been clarified in the code, and safeguards are now much more closely aligned to the threats. So the code contains more specific guidance on the types of threats in particular contexts and some potential safeguards then that might be relevant and applicable. And finally, there's a new requirement to step back, so to speak, when we're forming an overall conclusion. So that would be by reviewing the significant judgments that are made and applying the reasonable and informed third-party test, and also by reevaluating the threats if new information comes to light.
Okay, and on next slide then. So another relatively recent addition to the code is NOCLAR, standard that was the result of over 6 years of extensive multi-stakeholder consultation. NOCLAR sets out what's really a first-of-its-kind framework to guide professional accountants in what actions to take in the public interest when they become aware of a potential illegal act known as non-compliance with laws and regulations that are committed by a, or potentially committed by a client or an employer. Now this standard became effective in July 2017. This also includes a very clear pathway to disclosure of NOCLAR to appropriate public authorities in certain circumstances based on the professional accountant's role. There's really four different roles that are contemplated by the standard, and these look at the different responses by a professional accountant with proportionality based on what their role is. So different disclosure pathways and different expected responses based on the role the individual's in. So it could be that the individual is an auditor, or they might be another professional accountant that's in a public practice providing non-assurance work to a client, or they could be internal to the client in a senior level position as a professional accountant in business, or they could be a PAIB who's not in a senior role, but again, is within a client organization or simply an organization. So the sorts of laws and regulations that this standard targets are those having a direct effect on material amounts or disclosures in the financial statements, and those that may be fundamental to an entity's business and operations. So for example, things like fraud, bribery, corruption. Next slide then on inducements. Thank you. So the inducement sections, which are broken into two parts, again, depending on the role, section 250 for PAIBs and then 340 for those in public practice. These are additions that clarify the appropriate boundaries for professional accountants with respect to both offering and accepting inducements. Inducements being defined as objects, situations, or actions that are used to influence another individual's behavior, whether that's a positive influence or a negative influence. But importantly, there's a full prohibition on offering or accepting inducements that have the intent to improperly influence behavior, and also then a requirement to apply the conceptual framework when there is no actual or perceived intent to improperly influence behavior. Then the final point on the slide is simply noting that there were also conforming amendments that took place within the independent standards in sections 420 and 906 in relation to similar guidance around gifts and hospitality in that situation where independent standards apply.
Okay, perfect. If we can move on then to long association. Thank you. So next we'll take a quick look at the strengthened provisions around long association between auditors and their clients. And this project also took some time, and there were roundtables held and a significant amount of discussion, largely around the requirements for cooling off periods. So what had happened was that over time, other jurisdictions around the globe had implemented more restrictive cooling off periods than were in the code. So in the code now, the time on period is still 7 years, but the cooling off periods are now 5 years for engagement partners and 3 years for quality review partners. And any other partners would still have that 2-year cooling off period, which used to be the requirement across all partners. It's also important to note that there are restrictions around any technical consultations with a partner during the cooling off period. So whether it's the engagement partner or the quality review partner, there's no technical discussions allowed while a partner is on their cooling off period. And there's also a prohibition on acting as the client relationship partner during that cooling off period. There's some other additional revisions in the introductory or the general provisions, and they've really made it clear that the professional accountant needs to look at long association and the corresponding threats to independence that can result. And this is true whether it's a public entity or a private entity. So with respect to private entities, there's no specific cooling off periods that are stipulated, but there is a requirement that the professional accountant assess independence and whether or not there may be an issue with respect to how long the tenure may be of the engagement partner or potentially the quality review partner, or for that matter, any staff person who's on the engagement team. And as you can imagine, there are some additional complexities. So for example, when you have a partner who's the engagement partner for a certain period of time, and then they become the quality review partner. So the code goes into some of those specifics and complexities and provides some guidance there. This section came into effect as of December 2018. And there were also some restructuring changes as a result of the structure and safeguards projects, with substantive changes made to the examples of safeguards. And also note that in an additional long association FAQ is in the works in response to IESBA staff receiving some questions from some national standard setters and from some firms, principally regarding the application of the transitional provisions.
Okay, that's it for long association. Moving on. So on this slide, we really just wanted to recognize the importance of the broad range of stakeholder groups that provide insight and feedback to the code as it continues to evolve. The rollout working group and the board as a whole is asking all of you to get involved however you can to help us to increase the exposure to the new and revised and restructured code. The board's certainly doing the very best that we can to get the word out, but we're a limited group of people, and there's certainly a much broader group of stakeholders, including obviously IFAC member bodies and PAOs, governments, firms, the academic community, and so on, who can really amplify our voice and get members in these various organizations on board with the changes. So there's a role for everyone to play in terms of helping socialize this new code and also encouraging jurisdictions who might have implemented prior versions of the code to now upgrade to this latest offering. Definitely a worthwhile time to adopt, as hopefully we've been able to demonstrate through some of the changes that we've highlighted here.
Perfect. We can move on to the next slide, please. Thanks. Okay, on this slide, just some listing of some of the tools and resources that are available to you with respect to the revised and restructured code. Please, please go to the Ethics Board website. There's a dedicated page, and it's the link is there at the bottom of the slide for you. And the link will take you to all kinds of great resources as the new code comes into effect. The handbook is there, of course, but there's also a number of presentations and additional webinars that are available. If you're looking for a quick overview to provide to others, there's a one-page flyer that gives a really high-level look at the improvements. And at the other end of the spectrum, if you're looking for a whole lot of detail and detailed resources that are there, there are the basis for conclusions documents, as well as articles and some Q&As that are there. There's also a number of videos that are available on specific topics and more of those to follow. And one particularly exciting new resource that's currently under development is the E-code. And I'll turn it back to Brian to talk about that in a little bit more detail.
You bet. So here's the slide. Awesome. So the E-code project is tied to the release of the revised and restructured code with the intent of providing professional accountants and also other stakeholders with an innovative way to access the electronic code. And rather than using a static PDF or a simple online reference, this is really a web app. This project arose from stakeholder requests to enhance the facilitation of learning, compliance, and also enforcement of the code. So this web app is intended to enhance the accessibility and make the code much easier to use and explore. Some of the features that are being advanced include helping users better navigate and use the code in a way that reinforces that the restructuring, so the deliberate building blocks structure that's been improved and run throughout the code. Within the E-code, there's also links to non-authoritative material and to some guidance resources to help users work with some of the specific requirements, while also referring to broader resources to gain a fuller understanding to aid in implementation and interpretation and so on. So the plan is to have the E-code online no later than the June release date of the revised and restructured code, so only a few months from now. And I'm happy to say that we continue to be on target with that timing. So you should be watching your inboxes coming up here for opportunities for things like testing and then, of course, the full launch coming up before summer, well, at least summer in the Northern Hemisphere, winter for those of you in the Southern Hemisphere. Okay, and then next slide. So the last thing that we wanted to mention is just to take a brief look at what's coming up for the board. The IESBA strategy and work plan for 2019 through 2023 was finalized at the end of last year. And this sort of brings us full circle as we started out the discussion by talking about the central goal for the code to remain relevant in an increasingly digital world where technologies and business models are evolving quickly and are providing new professional opportunities and challenges for accountants around the world. So as we all go into the future, the IESBA's strategy and work plans are built around strengthening its public trust objectives and ensuring that ethics and trust remain at the core of how the profession adds value to society. Within the work plan, technology and service delivery models are pervasive strategic subjects, and there's a technology working group that's specifically exploring this area, particularly with respect to the ethical implications that may be created as a result of technology being used by professional accountants and their organizations in both business and public practice settings. There's also a number of pre-committed projects that were established under the prior strategic plan, and those continue to progress. So these are things like the E-code project that I just discussed, and also things like the role and mindset expected of all professional accountants that used to be the Professional Skepticism Long-Term Project, so it's now called the Role and Mindset Project. Provisions regarding non-assurance services, as well as the fees that are associated with them for audit clients. Some additional top priorities that the board is giving attention to are tax planning and related services. There's a group that's starting up very soon on this topic. Also the definition of public interest entities, listed entities, and materiality. And then finally, there are a number of post-implementation reviews that are going to be completed with respect to projects that are already out the door and ones that we've discussed, NOCLAR Long Association, and this overall revised and restructured code. So I think at this point we'll close by thanking you once again for your support of the code and ethics standards, of course, more generally. And we encourage you to reach out if there's more information or resources that you need in your roles as leaders of the profession and to really help champion the revised and restructured code.